everybody, and welcome to our episode here of Kim's Upholstery Live. Each week we share a new project with you. We try to do the projects with you start to finish, and sometimes they take multiple weeks. Last week I was not here, so we started this project 2 weeks ago. And as you come in, go ahead, and say hello. Hit that share button if you wouldn't mind sharing this feed out there with your friends on Facebook or YouTube, and bring them into the show as well. So this project is a chair that, if you remember, I painted this chair off camera. I painted this using a milk paint. I used Miss Mustard Seeds milk paint for this project. Last project I did, I used the chalk paint. I just really wanted to compare how the two paints worked, and I liked the color green that Miss Mustard Seed had, so I chose that for this rocking chair, and then, you know, the pink and turquoise that I used for those other projects we did painting with chalk paint. So last week, or 2 weeks ago rather, we started by padding this seat, and if you remember, this is a chair that's from my porch, so I'm really dying to get this done so that I can sit back in my chair, because I do enjoy sitting in this rocking chair out on our porch in the morning having my coffee, and sometimes at the end of the day having a cup of coffee as well. So we padded this chair together. We used a edge roll all the way around the edge. We padded it with a cotton, and as you know, I use the synthetic cotton instead of the 100% natural cotton. It's just my personal preference. Both products work just as well, but I prefer working with the synthetic cotton. And I always encourage you to try different upholstery supplies. You know, even if you're used to working with one, sometime order one of the other ones and try working with that. And you'll find that one may work better than the other for you. And it's really about the way you work. Then we were starting our fabric, and we made one cut in our back corner here. So that today we're going to make the other three cuts that we need to make to finish attaching this fabric. And then we'll be cutting the fabric, or trimming the fabric down with a razor blade, and attaching our double welt cord. Now, I did pre-make all the double welt cords. Finish the end so they're good to go and ready to just attach to the frame. I make my double welt cords using a 1/4 inch double welting foot, and I prefer the double welting foot. Some people make them with zipper feet because I get a nice consistent curve on the top portion of my double welt cording, and I also make my double welt cording with one pass. And if you've never made double welt cording, we do have a tutorial on that, and I show you how I make the cording. In the class I just got back from teaching in Flowery Branch, a lot of the women in the class had made double welt, but they had made it with a single welt foot or a zipper foot, so they had to do two rows of stitches. So I did show everybody how I do it with one pass, and I've only got one row of stitches then, and I think they all liked this method better and are all trying it. Some of them actually tried it right there in class. So again, as you come in to YouTube or Facebook, go ahead and say hello. Let us know that you're here watching this episode. And I encourage you, if you have any questions during the broadcast, to go ahead and ask them. We do try to answer you live during the feed, but I don't always get to them because sometimes it moves so quickly with people's comments that I don't get a chance to answer you live. But I try to go back afterwards and look at everything and answer any questions that I may have missed. So if your questions are on this project or maybe a project you're working on, either way, go ahead and ask them in the comments. If it's a project you're working on and you can post a picture, sometimes you can, sometimes you can't. It depends on how the platforms are playing that day. You know, you can post the pictures, and then I can answer them there as well. So let's get started and see who's out there. Is anybody out there yet? Looks like we've got some, I see some bubbles showing me that there's people out there. So hello, Red from New Jersey, and Colleen, and Debbie, and Susan is from Maryland, and then Kathy Bryant is also here. So thanks everybody for hopping in. That was on Facebook, and we got a couple of you over there on YouTube. We've got Tamara. Hi, Tamara. And then Bill's watching from YouTube. Cool, huh? Bill's actually running behind the camera. So if you remember last week, we made this, or 2 weeks ago, we made this one back cut. It was a single straight cut, and we're going to do the same thing in the front because of the direction we're hitting these posts. Now, there's a lot of times where you have to make V-cuts to get around the width of a post, but for this particular instance, we don't necessarily have to do that. So I'm going to go ahead and make my cut. And let's see, turn a little bit. Where are you? You're up above. Make my cut so that I can get around the side of this upper post here that is at the front of the arm. So I'm going to push my fabric down as far as I can get it. Oops, I'm dropping my tape measure, so let's just move that out of the way. You can mark your cuts with a pencil or other marking utensil if you want when you're learning how to make cuts. It's always a good idea to mark it and then double check yourself to make sure that you're where you need to be. Because the worst thing is to get the cut, oops, I shifted my fabric, lost it there, is to get your cut made and not have double checked yourself, and then you're off, because then typically you're starting over. Check and see if that's deep enough. And it is. So there you see one single straight cut, and now we've got the fabric wrapping around the front post of the arm, just the way I want it. So let me go ahead and pull my little stool over, and I'm going to go ahead and staple this fabric down. I don't fill in with a ton of tape staples until I'm positive that I've got everything the way I need it. There's no sense in having to take out too many staples if you adjust your fabric forward or backward. I'm just trying to get that nice fold along the front of the, or the back of the front post here. And then I'm going to come over from the back. So here I've made the cuts. Different camera, Bill. He's got, let us know if you can hear it well or not. Bill's hearing some noises. So I've got the back already stapled from 2 weeks ago when we made that cut, and I had put a staple in the center, and now I've got a staple here towards the front of the chair, and I'm going to go ahead and start filling this in. Oops, and that didn't go in all the way, so let me just tap that staple down. And on this piece too, it's very hard to feel where the groove is for the decorative wood, or where the, you know, the finished wood starts. Some pieces you'll actually have quite a ridge, so you can really feel it. Grab pullers here. One of the staples bounced back. It must have hit something in the wood. Just pull that out and put in a new one. So what projects is everybody working on out there? This temporary staple I am going to shift because I have a little bit of excess fabric in there. And I want to be careful not to ding my wood up too bad that I've already painted nicely and finished off. I used a wax, I think I told you guys that last week or 2 weeks ago, I used a wax to seal the paint. Staples in there just misfired is all. All right, so at the end I know I need to fold that fold a little deeper because I have some excess fabric, so let's go ahead and pop that out. Again, I'm trying not to dig up the wood any more than I have to. There we go. When you're going to an area where you know you're going to probably need an adjustment, that's where temporary staples come in really handy, because you don't have to worry about marking up your wood too much when you're using temporary staples. They're easy to lift. Fold it a little more. I think I've got a little bit too much folded underneath here, so let me trim some of that down. Fold it neatly and staple that last bit down, if I can hang on to it. See the staple poking out at me, I can see the head of it. This fabric really looks nice with this wood paint color too. I really like the, even though the exact green I don't think is really in the fabric, it really complements it well. Sometimes on camera the colors don't look quite the same as I actually see them. All Now we have one whole side completely stapled from front to back. And we'll go ahead and we'll finish stapling the front from the center over to this corner, and then we're ready to make the other cuts. And I can tell here I've got some excess fabric I'm gonna go ahead and trim off from underneath here. Turn a little bit so I can get a better grip here. And just before we were ready to go live, I was doing some teardown and I had a war with a piece of Curvy's and the Curvy's won. So hopefully no blood will seep through my Band-Aid here. Just looking to see where the decorative wood was. So does anybody else do a lot of furniture painting? I'm getting so I really like this painting furniture stuff. All right, now again, I have a little bit of excess. I'm gonna go ahead and pop that staple out. And here I was cocky and I didn't make it a temporary because I thought I was good. Actually, the next paint I want to try is that, I think it's called Infusion. Because I've never tried that, so just try them all and then decide which one I like. Because oftentimes, too, you'll want a specific color and some of them don't have the color, so it's good to experience a bunch of different ones. All right, so now this one is stapled from the center all the way over to the corner as well in the front. So now we'll go ahead and we'll make the back cut on the other corner and then the front cut. So let's see, who else is here today? We've got Tracy's here. Hello, Tracy, and Peggy, and Crystal, and Debbie, and Krista. And Susan says she can hear us loud and clear, and Melissa is here. Hello, ladies. So Red says there was lots of fuzz with your sound, but I can still hear you. Tracy's working on a velvet headboard today. Ooh, not fun, huh? Rhonda is here. Hello, Rhonda. And yeah, Rhonda, it's morning where you are. It's almost lunchtime here. Red says, I'm working on an old porter chair. I'm not familiar with what a porter chair is. I'll have to look that up. Bethany, hello, Bethany. She's finishing up Sunbrella slipcover for a love seat. And hello, Sandra. And Peggy says, what do you mean when you say used a wax? So I did a wax finish over the paint when I was done. So I applied a wax and then buffed it down. Like beeswax or something like that. I used an Annie Sloan over the top of this. And hello, Susan. She says, searching for a chair to do. What's the suggestion for a good style of chair to do for a true beginner? Maybe one like this. One with just upholstery on the seat. This is actually a good start because it won't get you discouraged and you'll learn a few of the skills that you need, but also something like the Martha Washington chair or the Queen Anne armchair that we have on our website are good beginner projects because they give you a little more detail. You've got a back and a seat. An eight-way tie is a really good experience for a beginner just to get the feel of how that works in a smaller seat rather than starting on like a sofa or something. So Colleen says, is this an outdoor fabric? It is not an outdoor fabric. It was a greenhouse fabric that I got, and I went to search this morning because I had two samples that came in and I had the cards from the two samples, and somebody had asked what one this was. Well, both of them are discontinued, so unfortunately this fabric can't be purchased anymore through greenhouse. But sometimes if you actually take a picture of something and do a Google image search, you can sometimes come up with the fabric from another vendor. Since it's discontinued from them. And like I said, I don't think it's an outdoor fabric. And hello, Susan, that's my sister-in-law. How are you? And Rhonda says, I like painting furniture. I have many pieces in my home that I have painted. I can't wait to see them when I come in September. I've definitely got the painting bug. Poor Bill's gonna come home one day and everything in the house is gonna be painted. Hello. Paint the walls too. Hello, Emily. She says, I have a furniture refinishing business and sell Fusion Mineral Paints. Love it. Great quality paint and lots of colors. And you're in Michigan. Do you have a Facebook page, Emily? I'll go check it out. And hello, Diane. And Melissa says she is doing dining room slipcovers and upholstering wingbacks. That's a challenging as a wingback, but I think you've done a few upholstery projects, if I remember correctly. And hello, Lynn. Lynn likes the chair. She says, beautiful chair. Susan, you'll have to come over and sit on the porch with us and have coffee in my chair once it's done, although no spill in it. All right, so now let's go ahead, although I'll probably be the first one to spill it because that's kind of my MO. All right, so now let's go ahead and make our cut on the back. Let's see what's going to be the best angle here. So again, I want to push it down to the point where I get resistance between the post and the deck. And this one, you know, I think I need to lower this, if I can lower this a little bit. But where is my button? Just to make this back cut, if I'm a little bit above the chair, it would be better. That's one great thing about these pedestals, is you can raise and lower them when you need it. There we go. And let me actually grab a pencil, because it'd be easier to mark this one and pull it out. We had lots of marking and cutting going on in the Flowery Branch workshop. All right, now if I come to the center of the chair, see if I spin this a little bit. So I know you guys can't see my pencil mark on camera probably, but and let's see how we did with that cut. Actually, I'm getting a little pucker, so I think I could go a little bit deeper. Probably just about a quarter of an inch, I would say. And if you have to go deeper, you want to go little bits at a time. You don't want to go and make like an inch deeper and then realize that that's way too much. There we go, much better. All right, so now I can go ahead and staple it from the center of the back over to this side. See, I think we can cut down some of this excess here as well. So I'll go ahead and fold it to the outside and just take off even a couple inches to fold underneath. Sometimes if you're trying to fold too much underneath, you just can't get it to lay nice. So if you're ever struggling with it, check that first, because that could be your problem. And then some fabrics just fight with you. And that's why I always say, let the fabric tell you what it wants to do, because oftentimes, if you pay attention to what the fabric's trying to do, it'll make your life a little bit easier. I'm just going to put this right back in the front so the chair stops rocking. Just making sure I'm up where I need to be, not too low. Closer to the edge here so I can get my gun where I need. All right, so that feels good on the back. So that's looking good. Now we'll go ahead and finish this opposite side here. And hello, Kevin. Thanks for joining us this morning or this afternoon. Go ahead and cut excess fabric off on this side. I'm going to go and get a temporary staple towards the back here. Although I think the back's a good temporary staple on the front when we get up there. The back should be good. Just trying to see where the groove in the wood is. Actually, I may have to refold that, so we'll get another temporary staple here. It's hard to tell yet until we get this front cut made. So Tamara, you said you're redoing an ottoman today. You have to post pictures in the community later. Let us see what you're working on. Where is my pencil? Although I don't know if I need it for the front, but let's check. So now it's the same cut again that we made on the other side on the front that we're going to make over here. Sometimes the hardest part is getting your hands down far enough in where you need to make the cut to feel everything. But then you get your hand down there and you can't really feel and you can't tell what's what. Because this is the awkward side for me, I'm going to go ahead and make a mark on this side too. It's like when you're left-handed or right-handed. One side goes easier for your marking and cutting than the other side. And if I turn that way, you guys are not going to see anything. Straight into my point. Now I'll check it. See how I did on my depth here. And that looks good. All right, so now I'll go ahead and get the front finish stapling and then come over to the side. And I've tangled my staple gun up. And we're almost ready to start hot gluing our double welt cord here, which I do have the glue gun heated up. Sitting sideways on my chair, that is not very comfortable. Here we go. Oops, I think I need to cut a little bit of that out. You get these funky points. And it's just a little triangle that I'm cutting out, but sometimes it just makes all the difference when you're trying to get that folded in there. Work my way all the way over. If I had to guess, I would say this is a linen poly blend fabric. Oops. Need a few more staples over here. Oops, that one kicked back out, so let's go ahead and pop that out and put in a new one. Okay. Now get a temporary staple on this end, and then we'll start filling in this side. Actually, before I fill this in, I want to go ahead and check the curve that I created on the other side because I want to try to match it as close. So I just kind of go take a look at it, see what it looks like, and come back over here so that I know what I'm aiming for. I definitely am going to need to fold that back corner a little more. Do that before we get too far in case I have to make more adjustments. The whole process of upholstery is oftentimes pulling staples, replacing staples, and it's just some fabrics will fight you and other fabrics you'll get on the first time. It's just really, you know, practice and experience, and sometimes the fabric is the culprit. Yeah, let's get that a little bit more. Now, next thing I'm going to need to do once we're done this is trim these ends all off with razor blade so that I can get rid of the excess fabric hanging down. Come on, scissors. Now, actually, in our workshop this past week, in Flowery Branch. One of the students was able to find, I don't know if you remember those curved scissors I was using live a few weeks ago. She was able to find a pair that the brand name was Klaus, C-L-A-U-S, and she found those on eBay. She had those in class. So if anybody is looking for those curved scissors still, check eBay. Now we have that back corner, and just to double check, what I'll oftentimes do is feel the two sides and make sure they feel consistent, and they do. So go ahead and continue. So now I'm going to continue coming towards the front of the chair. Did you guys see the pictures that I posted out there from Flowery Branch? They all did such a fabulous job. And one of the people in the class, Michelle, hers was the chair that had, was like a small navy blue print, and it had a lot of decorative wood on the chair. She had never upholstered a piece of furniture before. This was her very first project. So she definitely has the knack for upholstery, and she did a fabulous job on her piece. Everybody did a great job. But for a first time upholstery project, and it was, had a little bit of curve to it, so I had some difficulties. But she had listened to the pointers I gave her beforehand and picked the right fabric so that it had some stretch. And that's important too, is knowing what fabrics to pick for your projects as far as the properties of the fabric. But, and I'm sure you all saw Donna Cash's chair. She used her son's jacket from high school, or his letterman's jacket that he had, to upholster the chair. And it was a surprise for him, and I don't know if she's given it to him yet, but that was fun. So she actually had to deconstruct the whole jacket and make it into fabric using another fabric that she was attaching it to. And it was funny because she kind of had an idea before she got started, and then when she gets started, you know how it is, you get into something and then you completely change what you're going to do. But she did a cool job, and she even took the knit banding that was around the collar, and where she used one side of the front of the jacket for the front of the chair and one side for the back, she actually lined the banding up on top. And then instead of using welt cord, because she's all about zippers and pillows, she used zipper in there instead of a welt cord between the inside back and the outside back. It was pretty neat. But you can see those pictures that I posted. And I think there's a picture of that one that came out on Monday. But there's pictures during the workshop too. We've got one other staple that kicked out that we'll have to pull. And then I got a little bit excess here, so we'll make an adjustment there. And if you're interested in taking a workshop, we do have one spot left in Rhonda's, the workshop that Rhonda's hosting in Castle Rock, Colorado, and that is in September. And then we have one spot left in the one here in October, which is, they're both 3-day small chair. And then the class in Virginia, we still have a few spots left. And that one is in November. Hitting the edge of another staple and bumping these out. And sometimes that happens. Yeah. All right, so now we have all four sides all stapled down. So I'll just kind of go around, see if I need to add any more staples in anywhere, and then we'll go ahead and start trimming this. So you want enough staples in here so that when you trim it, your fabric doesn't release its tension. And I've got a couple high spots of staples here, so I'm gonna pop those and put a new one in. Sometimes you can hammer them, you know, tap them in, but I prefer to take them out because then I know I've got a good grip on the fabric if I put a new one in, it goes all the way in. This side, a couple spots here. And you don't want your staples to be too low on the wood, because then when you make your cuts, you might lose your fabric. I think I need to wait till it's done filling because it's kicking them back at me. Where'd it go? Here we go. Get my pullers. Yeah, let's try that again. There we go. Back. Looks like I need a couple more here and there back here. So have you ever cut your fabric and then had your staples let go because you cut too close to the staples? Not a good feeling, because at that point, you don't have any fabric left to yank on to attach. So you get no pull. It's good to like have your staple gun handy when you're starting to use the razor blade too, just in case you missed one and then you need to add a staple when you're actually cutting. So just when you think you have them all close together, and now I'm out of staples. Thought there was another, oh there it is. I knew I had seen another spot. Okay, so now let's go ahead and trim that down. And I'm just going to be using a straight edge razor blade. Actually, one of the women in the class, Pam, had this neat little tool to hold the razor blade that I'm going to see if I can find one, because it would save you from cutting your fingers, which I do sometimes. So Pam says, going back to waxing paint, what do you like the wax feel? I actually like the wax feel. I'm trying to remember now what I did. I used a round brush to put it on, the brush that they suggest for waxing. Hey, Tony. And then I buffed it with a old t-shirt. So I just cut up an old t-shirt and buffed it with that. And I liked the way it felt. But before I put the wax on, I actually did a really light steel wooling to the paint. But the one thing I found when I did those bright color chairs is I didn't take the time to thoroughly clean off the residue from the steel wool. And when I waxed those particular pieces, I ended up having spots that looked dirty, but what it was the fibers from the steel wool stuck in the wax. So this time when I did it, I actually took the blower on my compressor, put the blower end on, and actually blew the steel wool residue off, and then took a clean rag and wiped everything down before I put the wax on. So that would be one suggestion I would make, is if you're gonna steel wool or sand it, make sure you clean it first. I found out the hard way. So Crystal says, I'll start working on an ottoman, attach cushions in shiny red snakeskin vinyl with a skirt. You'll have to post pictures of that. That sounds really cool. And hello, Kathy and Kathy. And Tony says, yep, saw the pictures, so good. And Donna was totally over the top, wasn't she? She definitely was over the top with that. And hello, Jonix, thanks for joining. And Janet, and she says, spring tying today. And Candace is here from Texas. Hello, Candace. So bright and beautiful. Yeah, I love the colors here. And Peggy says, thanks for the information. You are welcome. All right, let's get her cut. And you definitely don't want to do this at the end of the day when you're tired, because that's when you end up making mistakes. So you want to make sure whenever you go to make these cuts that you are fresh and ready to go. And I am just going to ride right along the edge of the finished wood and then the indent where I've put the staples. Okay, now right here I've got a... don't have a staple up high enough, so I'm going to add another one. And if you hit a staple like I just did, and your thing is dull, go ahead, or your razor blade is dull, go ahead and grab a new one. Because if you're trying to work with a dull razor blade, you're just going to make a mess of your fabric. You're going to have a lot of frays going on, and you'll end up pulling so hard that you'll end up slipping, and you might cut your actual fabric. So they're cheap. Just go ahead and switch to a new razor blade. And then here's another one that's low. I need to staple up above it. That staple, I think, is so low that it's like almost on the decorative wood. Let's just get that right out of there. I didn't get the second end, but I think I can cut it down. Yeah. Which means as soon as I hit it, I will probably dull my razor blade, but getting into these very corners sometimes is test your patience for sure. All right, let's grab another one because I think I dulled that on the end of the staple. So while I'm going here and cutting, if you haven't already, go ahead and hit that share button if you wouldn't mind for us. And share this out on your Facebook or YouTube. You can share it on other social medias. All right, so the front is already cut. Now after this project, because we're probably going to be finished with this project this week, I would think, as long as my glue gun behaves itself, we are going to be starting some projects coming up using Big Duck Canvas. I don't know if you've heard of Big Duck Canvas. They are a company in right near Flowery Branch, Georgia, which is where I was. So I was lucky enough to make arrangements and actually go to visit Big Duck Canvas while I was there and talk to them. And we're going to be collaborating on some projects and using some of their fabrics for some upcoming slip covers and upholstery projects. And again, I dulled that razor blade. So I'm excited about that, and I've got some samples that they're sending me that will be in shortly, and then I can go ahead and pick out what I want for colors, because they got some different colors, but I wanted to see them in person. They got some great samples on the website that you can see. And one of the projects I'm thinking of doing, and this one won't be right away, it'll probably be the last project that I do out of the ones that I just mentioned, is a deconstructed upholstery. Now, I know that's one of those things that you either love or you hate, and most people hate, but I've been dying to try one, so I wanted to do this deconstructed, and Big Duck Canvas has some really great, bright, colorful burlaps. So if you've looked at the deconstructed upholstery projects, usually you have the burlap on the, it's actually on the inside of the chair, but it shows through the frame. So the outside of the chair is not upholstered. You see the actual construction of the frame. So I'm thinking that I might use one of their brighter color burlaps for that portion of the chair. And then I have a fabric picked for the interior that is a Jacobean. Actually, it's not really Jacobean. It's kind of like a Jacobean, but it's more modern print. And it's oranges and pinks and grays. So I'm thinking that with the contrast of the bright burlap against the wood, that it would be really fun. So that's what I'm planning on doing. And they're providing the fabric for me for this project. So I'm all excited about that and working with somebody from their company named Andy. So I'm really looking forward to using this stuff. And they've got some great, great 10 and 12 ounce canvases for slip covers too. So we're going to be doing a slipcover project. We'll do one live, and one will actually be a video tutorial, and then there's another one that's going to be a YouTube video. So you'll have to stay tuned for those. And then I've got a fun little funky chair that I haven't quite decided what I'm going to do with yet, but I'm thinking I might use one of their bright greens and pinks for this project. And I think my razor blade is dull again already. So you do go through a lot of razor blades, as you can see. And as you can see right here, I don't know if you can see that. Can you zoom in the camera, Bill?
Yep.
So they can, I can show them how not to, what not to do. So I had said I try to change razor blades as soon as it gets dull. And I don't know if you can see that on camera, but right here, the razor blade made a mess of my fabric, and I've got a lot of fraying edges because I didn't listen to myself and switch to a sharper razor blade. So now I've got to go back and clean up all that afterwards. But let's change razor blades and go ahead on to the back, and then I'll clean that up, like I said, after. But I'm also trying to keep all these razor blades in one spot so I don't grab one by mistake and cut myself. It's kind of like that do as I say, not as I do. I thought, oh, I can get that last inch. And it didn't work. Get this stern in. Like I said, getting into these corners sometimes is not easy. Because the back post here actually juts out from my frame probably about 3/4 of an inch. So I've got to try to get in close without wrecking my wood too. There we go. And now I'll go. Yeah, so when Bill does things like this, he likes an X-Acto knife. And he said you can get in those areas much better with an X-Acto knife. I just don't seem to have the control with an X-Acto knife. So sometimes I've actually said to him, can you cut areas like that for me? Because he can get in there with an X-Acto knife where I just don't have the control with the X-Acto knife that I feel like I have with a razor blade. So it's a personal preference. Some people use box cutters. You know, it just really depends on what works for your hands. I just kind of, whoops, get those out of the way here. Get that to lift the chair up a little bit more by pushing that little rug underneath further. All right, and here is a spot where I need to adjust the staples. Now I'm really good entangled around my pedestal. Let's just turn this around and get my gun untangled so that I can finish that. So my staples were pretty low, close to the cut, so I'm just going and making one little row right above them so that I have more grip on the fabric. There, that should do it. And that one is dull already. So let's see, so far I have used 5 razor blades and I'm on number 6. Sometimes you don't hit as many staples and other times you do.
I think we have quite a few comments here.
Okay. Read that one already, Bill. I did see that one earlier. And I saw that one. Ragnay, thanks for joining us. If anybody has not checked out her business page, it's Felix Hart, and she has a gorgeous blue velvet tufted headboard that she's selling right now. Better late than never, she says, yes, it is. And hello, Janet, thanks for joining. And Candace says, I have too many half projects going on. And she says, hi to Ragnay. Yeah, I know how that is. It's like I have half projects, but they're not upholstery related. And Sandra says, your chair with the feathers was amazing, Ragnay. And she says thank you. And let's see, Deborah's joined us. And let's see, Janet says deconstructed, yes, can't wait to see you do it. Deborah Legman says, Kim, I'm late but happy to be here. And Sandra says, exciting news, I have heard good things about them. Big Duck Canvas, I'm assuming you're referring to. And Candace says, I have a patchwork leather that feels like it's taking me forever. Yeah, patchwork is definitely going to take some time because you're making the fabric as well as upholstering with it. So that definitely adds a lot of time to your projects. I'm pro at funky, Ragnay says. I see a collaboration in the near future. And Deborah says, how in the world do you keep your workspace so neat? We clean it for camera, Deborah. It doesn't look this neat when I'm working on a project, let me tell you. In fact, we were talking about that in the workshop because we all were just like throwing stuff on the floor, but then we clean it up at the end of the day.
Turn the camera around, show them the mess.
Yeah, show them the teardown area that we were doing earlier. And Catherine says she loves the colors. Thanks, Catherine. And Ragnay says, you know what's great for those corners? Manicure scissors. Now, that's a good idea. Never thought of that. That is a very good idea. I actually have some of those at home. And Sandra says, razor blades used to be my go-to seam ripper. I've used them for seam rippers too, but sometimes that's scary. And Candace says, yeah, I was going to say those tweezer scissors, but I guess actually manicure scissors. And hello, Linda. Thanks for joining us. And hello, Sandra. She says, beautiful chair. And Tony checked out your page, Ragne, and says, really nice. Yeah, she's got some beautiful stuff over there. And collaboration sounds like a fun idea to me. All right, let's go ahead and finish this so we can get some hot gluing going on. See, and I wrecked it again. Almost to the corner. This is also where my fabric is folded underneath, so I'm going through two layers, and there's a staple right there close to the edge that's causing me problems. Let's try these little scissors. I don't have manicure scissors, but let's see if I can get in there closer with this. These are sharp enough. And I think they're going to be. Good. Okay. All right. A piece of Dacron hanging down there, or cotton. All right, one more side. And Tamara says, I have used and love Mason Blanc metallic paint. It gives a nice sheen and very soft. My favorite color is warm silver. I have never heard of that paint before. I'll have to check that out. And she's posting that over on YouTube for those of you on Facebook going, where's that comment? Where's my staple? I mean my razors. Here we go. Last side, and then we are ready for hot glue. Positive thinking, this is going to be my last razor blade, right? Maybe not. See, that one went really smooth. Okay, where's those little scissors? I should have actually brought my apron that Donna and I made out here. I actually went to Flowery Branch a day early so Donna and I could have a play day together. So we made aprons, pinafore style aprons, and we actually did kind of like our applique technique, but more random. There, okay, so now that side is all trimmed and we are ready to go ahead and hot glue. Add in a couple staples just to be safe. Now next month, actually, it's hard to believe that July is already next week. This year is just like flying by. So next month, I'm actually headed to Hickory, North Carolina for a 3-day workshop. And from there, I'm going to High Point, North Carolina. And we have, I think, about 23, 24 people meeting there for an upholstery meetup in High Point. And we're going to take a tour of greenhouse fabrics. And we're also going to a furniture frame company called Ralph's Frames. And we're going to take a tour there as well. And They'll both give us some information on their products and how, like, the. I'm interested in the furniture frame company because a lot of people don't understand the quality of some of the construction. So that'll be fun to actually talk with a manufacturer who manufactures in this country. And actually, Bill's got a picture up there, I think, for you, or we'll be putting a picture up there for you so you can see what it looks like in their company. So that's going to be fun. And then I'm also trying to hook up with a sewing machine place, and I was looking for a trim company, but I have not been able to find anybody who has what I was looking for trim. So we'll see what else we're gonna do, but it's gonna be fun. We've got husbands and wives both going together. So we will have a good time. So let's go ahead and start on the front. And I'm hoping that this is the first of many upholstery meetups, because it's always fun to have conversation and get to know people that enjoy the same things that you do. So isn't that gonna look pretty? So we're gonna go ahead and glue that right on here. And like I said, I made it up ahead of time. I finished the ends off already. So we're good to go with that. Let me just snip some of these little threads that are hanging. And I've been told that it's gonna be hot when we get a high point, so gonna have to dress cool. Let me pull my cart over here that has my glue gun. And I use just a no-name hot glue gun for my projects. It's nothing special. I just got it at a hardware store locally. So you don't need a fancy with all the bells and whistles, although I don't know if hot glue guns have bells and whistles, but I don't have all the different tips either. I know some people have the varying tips for their glue guns. But you just want one that works well and heats up nice. Hold that for a second before I glue the rest. Sometimes I'll actually use pins to hold it up there, just so that while I'm getting the glue gun ready, it doesn't let go if it hasn't set yet. Whoops, and I got a drip. Although, you know what? I'm just gonna let that dry and peel it off the paint afterwards because it's quite the drip. And it's too much for my regulator, so we'll let it dry and then clean it up, and hopefully I don't have to touch up the paint, but if I do, I do. It kind of gooed out at me when I was trying to squeeze the trigger. Let's see, Jackie says, hi Jackie from Alberta, Canada. I have that fabric and love it so much. Where did you get yours, Jackie? Because I know the supplier I got it from, it's been discontinued, so somebody was asking about this. If you happen to know offhand, that would be awesome if you could share that. Come on, you. Seems to not be wanting to, there we go. I think it was just stuck, had a sticky glue ball in it or something.
So Peggy was asking why the blades get dull so quick.
The blades get dull so quick because I'm hitting staples. As soon as you hit a staple, and sometimes it may be like the leg of a staple that's in the wood underneath where you've removed your stuff from previously. And the minute you hit one, it definitely makes them dull. Glue gun is not playing nice today. I left a couple drips here that I have to remove. But they're much easier if I just let those glue drips harden and then pop them off afterwards rather than trying to do it now and making a mess. So when my glue gun starts behaving like this is usually when I get a new one. And when I squeeze it over the board, it comes out really nice. When I'm trying to squeeze it under the chair, it's not being so nice. Let's go ahead and do this side. Check myself, but I did have these all laid out where they went beforehand to make sure I had the right sizes in the right places. Because the two sides are one size and the front and back are both different sizes too. So there's three different size pieces here. Another thing that you could do is lay your chair on its side, which sometimes makes it a little bit easier.
Candace is asking about the shirt on the wall.
So the shirts on the wall are my Addicted to Upholstery shirts that have our name on them. And I got them for just playing around with. A few of members who have done videos have them. Let's see. I'm gonna cut that little bit of fraying right there. This glue gun is wanting to squirt out chunks of glue, so I'm gonna go a little bit slower on this side to hopefully avoid having those big drips. And you can come back with a razor blade sometimes and get these little hairs, or you can just take little scissors to them. Sometimes you can tuck them and get them to stick up in the glue as well. I think they're actually on the cording. The regulator. There we go. Rather than trying to clip them all, scooch them back up into the glue. Actually, that one's gonna have to be trimmed because it's not scooching up. Scooching, that's a very technical upholstery term. And I'm dropping my tools. Regulator is one of those things you have to have as an upholsterer. It's like your third hand. You can use it for things like this, like pushing the glue down in. You can use it as a tool to hold something if you need to staple it and you can't get your fingers and the staple gun in there. You can use it for that type of a situation. You can also use it for manipulating your padding in projects as well. Debbie says, are you trying to hook up with Bill's sewing machine? This is a real cool place. It's not Bill's. It's one that's right in High Point, and I cannot think of the name right off the top of my head, but I do have notes on it. It was one that Sandra had mentioned to me. But Bell's, I don't think, is near where we're going. Let's see. Candace says, I find a lot of cool bells and whistles on Etsy shop. I have to check that out, too. I go to Etsy once in a while, but I don't go there. I don't think to go there very often. And hello, Sandy. And Colleen says, how do you finish the ends of the double welt? I actually have stitched them down. So they're all stitched down in place, and I do show that on the tutorials on our website, how I do that. But that way they're nice and finished, and I don't have to worry about trying to finish them in my project. All right, let's go two more. Let's see, can I get them done in 4 minutes? I don't know.
You can finish them off.
Yeah, I can finish the last one off camera. But here we go, the back one. Just double checking again, make sure I have the right one in the right place. Yeah, I think it is time for a new glue gun because this glue gun is just not squeezing out consistently like I like it to. No, I don't need it now. Whoops, that's upside down. I'm just taking my time so that I don't make a mess. Yeah, sometimes you make a mess with hot glue gun and you can ruin a project there too if it's in the middle of your seat or something. Pretty smoothly that time, so maybe it's just had a glob stuck in it or something and I needed to get past it. Tuck my tails. Whoops, I tucked one tail and created another one. And when you get glue on your regulator, take it off, because if you try to poke anything else with the glue on there, you'll end up making more of a mess. There you go. That one went on really easy, so I think my gun's going to behave now. And somebody had seen the pictures from Flowery Bants and said, what's the hair dryer in the picture? Well, you need a hair dryer handy sometimes when you're hot gluing double welt cord or gimp on, because you can use the hair dryer to heat the glue back up so that you can make adjustments if you needed. And that's what we were using the hairdryer for. So let's see, Sandy says, what's the best way to remove glue from the furniture? I find that if I don't touch it, if I make a drip and I don't touch it and I leave it and let it dry, I can usually take the regulator and pick it right back off the fabric and don't leave a mark. But if our instinct is to go paw at it and try to mess with it. And if you touch it when it's hot, then you sink it further into the fibers so that way it's harder to get out, and usually you can't get it all out unless you can I've sat there and just gently picked at them before to get little chunks off. But the best way is to not touch it, let it dry completely, and then it'll pop right off usually. Not always. Okay, where's my little scissors here? Let's go ahead and trim my whiskers over here. Okay. Double check, make sure I made it the right size. Even though I checked everything earlier, I just check and double check. Let's take some of these little whiskers right off here before we start gluing. Those are some long whiskers. There's other ways you can finish the ends of cording too besides sewing. You can do some staple techniques to get the ends stapled before you glue it all down. Can't tell how far I went with my glue. I think I went that far. Oops. This one might be a smidge long. Let's see. There we go. There we go. Now let's come back and get these little whiskers out of here. So we now have all the double well cord glued on our chair, and I will come back and pop off this dry glue. It's almost dry enough. Pop that off with my regulator afterwards, but I want to thank all of you for joining us today. Whoops, as I run myself over with my cart, for this episode of Kim's Upholstery Live. For those of you that are members, we will be live at the for your afternoon Q&A at 3 o'clock in your membership portal, so you can go ahead and log in there. The chat is up and the video is there ready to start. So go ahead and type any questions that you might have, or if you have specific projects, you can also post photos in the community and then just tell me to go look at the photos and I can do that to answer your questions during the Q&A. But thanks again, everybody, and we will see you right back here next week. I might be starting a slipcover project next week. It'll see how fast I can get the fabric chosen from Big Duck Canvas, and if so, we'll be working on that project. If not, we'll find another simple project to do for you in between. But thanks again, and we will see you all next week, and I'm gonna hope that this comes off and I don't have to touch up my paint.